You are on mute.
Sorry. Yeah, am I audible now? Yes. Hi, Mr. Nishant, can you hear me? Hi.
Thank you for
joining us here today, sir. We have startups from our incubation program who have joined to discuss and learn from you the common legalities of building a startup and a business. So thank you so much for joining us today. And I think we can just start the session. We have all the teams here.
Sure. Firstly, just want to know if everybody can hear me.
Yeah, we can hear you. Good.
Okay.
Could you make it a bit louder?
Okay. So, is it better now?
Yeah.
Thanks. So good morning, everybody. I hope, firstly, that everybody's staying home and staying safe. And, I know these are exceptional times, we haven't in our ages haven't seen something like this, and neither have our parents, really, in that sense. Don't know about my grandparents, but at least our parents, and we haven't seen something like this. And it's really affecting everybody in a sense where people have had to take extraordinary steps to mitigate any losses or any situations which have come forth. So, frankly, I'll just go by whatever you have to ask, and I'll be happy to answer if it's in my capacity to be able to help you out, and we'll take it like that. So, if you have the floor is open to questions, let's start.
Okay, so we can just go team wise. You can ask any question that you have. So. Cracked connections. Do you have any questions with respect to?
Yeah. So actually, we are first-time entrepreneurs. Hi, I'm Vibhur. This is Atish with me. So, just wanted to understand, like, what kind of shares and like what kind of shares are there initially, and when the first investors come in, what sort of agreements do we need to take care of? Like that.
Being an entrepreneur, obviously, you can always start your business in three forms. One is a proprietorship firm. The other is a partnership firm, which again gets divided into two. It's a normal partnership or an LLP, limited liability partnership. And then thirdly, you form a company. Again, a company can be a one-person company, one-director company, or even can have more than one directors, which has been the norm for so many years. It's only the 2013 Act which got the concept of the one-person company. Now, as far as shares go, shares can only be a part of a company if you incorporate a company. As far as partnership or proprietorship go, you will not have options of really doling out shares. Now,
we are actually registered as a private limited company.
Yeah. So in terms of shareholding, there are two kinds of shareholding. One is a preferential shareholding. One is there an equity. In my experience, whenever we've had investors come and invest into a company, we've usually had the company give out preferential shares. And not equity, just to hold on to the kind of ownership that they wish to have over the company. However, people have also given equity, so that's primarily your decision at the and the way you negotiate with your investor. But the kind of agreements that you'll probably have to deal with is probably a shareholders agreement, which will be common across all investing rounds that you'll have. Because the shareholders agreement is what governs your right and their right in your company and what kind of shares you're giving. And in terms of various other concepts like dilution and whether buyback options are given or not, and how much money is coming in, how much shares are being given in lieu of that money. So all that will be governed by your shareholders agreement. In terms of any other compliances, that's a different aspect altogether, because then once you've had your shareholders agreement, you also need to comply with company law regulations. You need to upload all the compliances with the Ministry of Corporate Affairs and get approvals and all that. So that's a separate aspect.
What's the difference between these two, preferential share and equity?
Preferential would be just, okay, so I think an example would help you understand. When you buy shares on the stock market for a company,
mm-hmm.
those are preferential shares. You are a preferential shareholder.
Mm.
And if somebody gets a stake, let's say you have 100% stake in your company, mm. and somebody buys your stake, let's say he takes 20% of your stake, your stake gets reduced to 80%, okay? And he becomes 20%. That's equity. So that's the simplistic way of explaining preferential and equity.
Yeah.
If you a detailed and a more bookish way will just complicate issues, I feel.
Yeah. Mm. Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
We can move on to the next team, Vibhor and Atish, if you don't have any more questions.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Okay, Akshay, do you have any questions?
Hello, Nishant sir.
Yeah, hi.
Hi. So I have 2-3 questions. First is, I'm using, my app is basically based on content, and I'm using 2-3 different APIs.
Mm.
So I want to know the copyright issue might come if I, rather than using the website directly, I'm using through API, fetch the data. So what would be the copyright issue in this scenario?
See, copyright, it's a little difficult to assess copyright issues when you come down to websites and copying websites or copying data from other websites, or even for that matter, let's say you're copying a certain mode, the way that service is being provided through a website. So copyright primarily is based upon literary forms or artistic forms in your field. Now, literary forms would completely include softwares. Now, if you're actually using a software, let's say, which has been created by another developer, and you're using it without a license, then definitely there is copyright infringement. However, if it is a free software available on the internet, which you can download for free, then there's no copyright infringement, obviously, because it's obviously there on the internet for free, and there's no commercial aspect to that. However, if you're denying somebody commercials by using a particular software without paying that commercial to that person, there is copyright infringement. So in that sense, yes, if you copy a website, let's say, I'll give you an example. We did a case for India Bulls. Now, India Bulls is a prime, and we did it for India Bulls Realty. Now, India Bulls Realty had a fabulous website. It had the web address as well. Somebody opened a similar website with a slightly different web address and copied the website, the module, the way it looked. And we had to go to court, and we got a stay against that person because it looked very similar, and it was damaging India Bulls, not only commercially but also reputation wise. So till there is commercial value to what the person has created, and then eventually you are copying that, or you are harming him in terms of commercial value, then there could be copyright infringement in that sense. But copyright per se, if you want to understand it, it's primarily on artistic work, literary work, dramatics, cinematographic work. So all these kind of works have copyright protection.
My second question is, I want to do file 2-3 patents for my concept.
Mm.
And I try Startup India lawyers. They have the list, but no one is responding. It's a concept and it's not proven. So I just wanted to do the patent for them. So my point is, how can I do the lowest cost patent filing cycle?
That's a difficult question to answer. See, the point is that when it comes to cost of writing a patent, getting it protected, and obviously doing the middle work where you get you'll have to write a response to the patent office and all that, it does take a lot of time. It takes a lot of effort. It usually involves a decent team to write a patent, to be able to present it to the office in a proper format. So that is why the cost is very high. Now, giving a ballpark figure, when you compare it to a trademark registrations are being done for anywhere between 5,000 to 7,500 rupees per trademark, which plus additionally the government fee. However, patents are anywhere between the lowest probably you'll find will be about 50,000 for and we've done it for about 75. So
complete cycle.
We've tried to cover as much as possible in that, because sometimes we've had people who've come to us with interesting concepts. We've liked the concept, and however, they haven't had the pocket to spend on that concept, and we've not in a way we've tried to protect the concept. So we've done it for a much lower fee, and we've tried to cover as much as possible. So that's how we work. But again, if you go to a big, really big law firm who completely specializes in IPR, they'll probably just charge you 2-2.5 lakhs for the entire thing.
My last question is, there's a patent act in business model strategy, I think. So,
get that. What were you trying to say?
So I think I read somewhere, I when I was researching for the patents, that there is a norm in India for the patent. You can patent on the business model strategy, I guess.
No. We've tried to work on that. See, a business model is something which is, it either be so unique that it's never been created, never been done ever in the world,
right.
Which is very difficult. I mean, I have never come across. We had a very big company come to us really saying that, oh, we've created a B2B model, which is so unique and so rare in terms of identifying the original product from the counterfeit that we need to get this patented. But it was pretty much what everybody else was doing. So, I mean, people think that it's unique, but it doesn't really turn out to be that unique. Business models, definitely not something. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you.
Thanks, Akshay. Let's move on to the next team. Anand, do you have any questions?
Hello, Nishant.
Hi.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm good too. So basically, my startup name is Accord, and we are working on EHR platform, electronic health record system, and personal health record system based on blockchain methodology. Actually, we are a registered company, and all the compliances are managed by our own compliance manager. So basically, my question is about the patent. India does not allow software patents. Therefore, how we can protect that from being stolen? Actually, we are using some new technologies that are not available in the market.
So is it a software?
Is it a software? It's a software.
Well, then you can go for a copyright protection. You can always apply for copyright. And once you have a copyright in your favor in terms of that software, then you can start licensing it in case you want to. And then in the alternative, if you feel that somebody else has created a similar software, which is primarily based on the way and on the foundation that you had created your software, then you can have an actionable claim against that person also.
Actually, sometimes some other startups or some other companies build the same software, but to remove copyright, they the method they are building or they are claiming the name are different. So how we can protect from that?
The name can, the name,
the technology they are using that they built.
See, the point is when it comes to proving how similar or how different a software is from the other, you obviously need technical experts. So if you really want to understand how the procedure works, I'll just give you a 2-minute sort of flowchart on that. What usually happens is if a company feels and has copyright protection over a certain software, and then suddenly feels that another company has created the same software or similar software on the same basis, doing the same thing, maybe a different name. Obviously, they will not use the same name because that'll just really close their case. But if they're using a different name, they can definitely issue a legal notice to that person saying that it's the same software, you're doing the same thing, we have copyright protection over it, and you can't do that. However, we'd be happy to license it to you, and you can sell it further in case we allow sub-licensing. But if they don't stop, then you have a court to go to, and then the court can sort of look into your matter and appoint a technical expert to assess whether there is actually similarity or not, and whether somebody has really copied. See, I'm not a technical person, but as far as I feel that in a software, you need a certain language, that there's coding language, and it's actually the coding language which actually gives way to assess whether it's actually a similar software or not. So the technical expert can always assess the coding language and assess whether it's same or not.
So and the last question is, should we go for technology patent? But we are like using the technology that is not like other companies are not using those technology. But we build that technology algorithm, so we can go for the patent for those.
See, that I can't give you an answer right away, because it's best that we study what you're using and what you're doing. Because without really studying the technology that you're using, it's very difficult to tell you whether you can go for one or not. So I mean, they'll
yeah, actually
completely be based upon what it is really.
Yeah, actually I've gone to WIPO patent search engine. So I've gone to almost 200 patents from the blockchain technology. But none of the similar technology or the method they're using to patent that.
No, that doesn't necessarily mean that yours is unique or novel in any manner. It has to there's a benchmark under the Patents Act which you should cross the threshold, because otherwise it's very difficult to get a patent registration. Believe me, we all think that what we've created is very unique and novel, but when it comes to testing it on the criteria prescribed under law and the international regulations, it sometimes does fall short, and therefore registrations are not granted. However, I'm not discouraging you. I'm not saying that it might not be. I'm just saying that once we have the entire setup before us, the technology that you're using and the way it's done, and we assess it on the criteria that are laid out before us in terms of law, when we test it on those criteria, maybe it'll happen, it'll not happen. That only once we've read your thing, we can assess.
Okay. That's all depend on us.
Hello, sir. Sir, I'm with Anand. And considering we are into EHR, we have a lot of patients' data, healthcare data. So with that kind of data, there comes a lot of issues regarding the security. Though we are compiling with the HIPAA compliances, and which are in USA, and the Indian compliances as well. So, still, what sort of issues can we face when? Particularly when we are pitching it to the people, like the base customers.
But what is your market?
So our market is in B2C, it's the general customers, which are patients.
No, it's in India only.
So yeah, we are starting it with India.
Which cities would you be targeting?
We'll be starting with New Delhi, definitely.
Okay. No, there are obviously compliances and data privacy, and when you talk about medical records, definitely there's a higher responsibility upon you to protect the data, because as you would be seeing even in today's times, when there's a reporting being done about patients who have contracted the virus, you would have very rarely seen that anybody has been named or anybody has been identified with regard to their address, until and unless it's a government record. So as I said, the responsibility is much higher. In terms of protecting the records and everything, there are compliances, obviously, by the medical council also. There are various aspects which the Supreme Court has prescribed in terms of guidelines. And there are judgments to the effect of how you should protect the privacy of a patient or a person who's ill with certain particular diseases. So those are aspects which you need to keep in mind. However, compiling such records, keeping such data is which a lot of people are doing. That's something which started at least a couple of years back. We helped out a couple of startups who were doing that. And the primary aspect which you should definitely take care of is that there should be enough safeguard, enough mechanism in your website or whatever software that you have, that it doesn't get leaked. So that is something. The security aspect is foremost that you should definitely take care of, because if something like that happens, you're looking at a very large amount of action against you by a lot of people, and which the US calls it a class action. There could be, it's not recognized in India, a class action, but eventually you will have a lot of people coming to you under the Consumer Protection Act, or probably even in a civil court for damages. So that's something which you will definitely have to take care and keep in mind.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Raju, do you have any questions?
Yeah. Hello. Hello. Hello, Nishant. How are you?
Hi, I'm good. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good. So basically, we are based on designing. So designing, that's the artist and basically Indian artistic culture. So do we have to go for every design for that's like a copyright or anything like patent, or we just have to copyright? So what types of legality we have to do against?
Okay. Yeah. Oh, so may I just understand a little more from you, what kind of designs, what is your basic product eventually?
So basically, so we provide a single platform to all artists and artisans. So the different artists give their design to artisan, and artisan just print out that particular design on, it may be a jute bag or it may be that's a crockery item. So these are the things. So we are basically dealing in design part only. So okay. That is the thing. Yeah.
No, so you design and you provide it to the local artisan, and then the artisan creates it.
Exactly.
And and what is your commercial model, and how do you earn?
So that is basically as per market requirement. At first, we research what type of design the market want. And after that, we give that particular design to our artisan, and then we bring that product to the market.
So you're dealing in physical offline modes, or online?
So both. So at present, we are running a contest in Instagram, Facebook as well. Okay, so to understand what is the market requirement. And moreover, we do have 300 plus artists onboarded. So they also give us different types of design, that this is the market requirement. So as per that, we just get a collection of all the designs, and after a particular voting, or we just share all the design in our social media. So whenever we get a particular number of likes and comment on a particular design, so that we will give to our artisan, that yes, this is the design which we want in our this product.
Okay.
After that.
Okay. So, now, there are various aspects involved in your business, and I'll go one by one.
Yeah, sure.
As I've understood. Now, there's an artist involved who's exactly. just designing, okay? Who's exactly. just designing the concept and the design, okay? Now, that is that person employed by you? He's on your roles, or is he a freelancer, or how does it work?
So, at present, they are freelancer. However, with passage of time, we hire on full-time basis.
Do you have any agreements with these freelancers?
Yeah, so we have agreement like that whatever design they shared with us will not share with any other. So this is the agreement at present.
And what provision do you have regarding ownership of the intellectual property?
So that is the thing we don't understand, unable to understand. So at present we just do a generic agreement.
That's why I wanted to understand. Now, what this really creates is a situation where this person is designing for you. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, either the intellectual property will reside with him, the ownership will reside with that person, or it will reside with you in case you have a particular agreement with that person saying that whatever you create for us, the ownership will be with us. Okay.
Okay.
So there has to be clarity on that aspect, number one. Number two, when you have a design in place, and if you feel that that design is worthy of commercial use, which means that you can sell it further in the market, or you feel that you can make revenue out of that, I would recommend you get it protected in some sort of manner, whether it's copyright or trademark or whatever. I'm still not being able to get what exactly your product will be. Maybe a design protection also. I mean, for all you could be creating a let's say a cup which is so unique in its design that it might come under design protection also. So so that is one.
Mm-hmm.
Now, artisan who makes it, the local artisan who makes it, he can only there's this dilemma between the person who's created the design and who's actually making it for you. So I would recommend that you actually have agreements with both the person who's making the design and also making the product, where you say for both these people that whatever IP, the intellectual property, rests in the design and the product rests with you and your company, and you will have ownership over it. They will only be given a royalty over whatever they've created, or will be given a certain amount towards creation of this design. Okay. So that will only help you in firstly protecting the IP, the intellectual property that you have over all these designs. Number one. Number two, how to protect them. Now, when you have a design in place and you have about 10 designs, let's say, on your website, either you can get your website copyright under the copyright regime, or you can apply for a copyright for each design, which means that it will definitely cost you not cost you so much, but at least it'll be a time consuming process and procedure, because it will definitely involve you applying for every design separately for a copyright protection. However, that is why I was saying that in case you feel that there is a particular design which is so unique and it is one of your best products, or probably will give you a lot of commercial value, I would recommend you get that protected.
Okay, so
I'll give you an example. Like a fashion designer, when they come up with dresses and all, they come out with a brochure which they get printed and then apply for copyright protection. That is the easiest way of protecting their designs. The more tedious way of protecting their designs, the way they do it, is that they apply for protection for each design that they create, which is a long drawn procedure, but of course gives them protection over each design. So it's how you really want it is you can customize it accordingly.
Okay.
But so the agreements are most important between your company and
artist.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Okay, so that's all from me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nishant.
Okay, Keshav, do you have any questions?
Yeah. Hi. Hello, sir. Keshav this side from Nirekar Technologies. So my question is that we are a registered company and we are building a product which we have named Sia. So what legalities should we take care of? Because the product that we are building has a different logo and a different name.
Mm.
So how does it go? Usme bhi kuch hame alag se uski bhi privacy policy ya copyright.
What is the product? If you could explain the product a little.
Please. Oh, so it is a AI based product that is used to recognize the yoga posture of a person.
Mm. Mm.
And it gives suggestions to the person in real time that how they can correct their alignment while performing the yoga asanas.
Mm. Mm.
So we are also collecting the data of the user, and we will be using the data also. So the other question mera yehi tha ki hum data user se collect kar rahe hain, to wo user ko hum kaise kisi legal terms mein believe kar rahe hain ki unka data hamare alawa like koi aur nahi use karega, hum use karne wale hain aapke data ko.
And this will be through an app or a website?
Yeah, it's going to be a mobile application.
Yes. So first question, where with regard to protection of your intellectual property, I think you should definitely try for getting it patented. AI technologies these days are getting a lot of patents. I don't know whether there's already an AI technology to recognize yoga postures or not, but we can definitely try. The second IP protection you should get is with regard to your name, the name of the product or the app that you'll run it under. And the logo and everything. So these are the ways you can protect your intellectual property. Now, in terms of data privacy and data protection, you must have noticed whenever you use an app, you always get a certain terms of use and privacy policy, which are created for that app or a website for that matter. And most terms of use or have a small tick box right in the end saying I acknowledge and accept the terms and conditions for use of this app or this website. And you tick that box, the person who's using the website or the app ticks that box, and that's a binding agreement, because electronic agreements in that sense have been recognized, and it binds the person who's providing the service as also the person who's taking advantage of that service in a contract based on the terms and conditions that are specified in that contract. So you can also do the same. You can have a terms of use for your app, which can be used as an agreement for your client to say that these are the terms and conditions based on which you'll be using this app, and you'll be bound by them.
Okay, so जैसे New Record Technologies is the main company and CIA is a product of the company, right? So हमें से कुछ child company या वैसे भी कुछ register कराना पड़ेगा या फिर it works कि
जैसे company, sorry, I didn't get that.
Like a child company or it's इसी का part है, how it gets.
अच्छा that like that CIA is a part of your company. जब आप apply करेंगे registration के लिए तो रजिस्ट्रेशन में किसके नाम पे अप्लाई करेंगे वहां पे एक ये कॉलम होता है, तो या तो वो एक पर्सन हो सकता है या कंपनी हो सकती है. तो अगर आपको कंपनी के नाम पे अप्लाई करना है रजिस्ट्रेशन फॉर सिया, तो वो भी कर सकते हैं. तो वो डायरेक्टली आपको वहां पे जब रजिस्ट्रेशन मिलेगी उस प्रोडक्ट तो वो कंपनी के नाम पे आएगी, तो वो डिफाइन हो जाएगा कि कंपनी का प्रोडक्ट है वो.
तो ऐसा कराना पड़ता है लाइक या फिर नहीं
जब आप रजिस्ट्रेशन, मैं वही कह रहा हूँ, जब रजिस्ट्रेशन के लिए अप्लाई करेंगे ट्रेडमार्क हो या पैटेंट हो, तो आप वहाँ पे जो एप्लिकेंट होगा वो कंपनी होगा, वो पर्सन नहीं होगा, वो कंपनी होगा. लाइक मैं एग्जांपल दूं तो पेप्सी का जो लोगो है वो पेप्सी को के नाम पर है, वो किसी एक इंडिविजुअल के नाम पे नहीं है. हेलो,
या got your point.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you, sir. These are my questions.
Yeah. Okay, we'll move to Shubham.
Yeah, hello, sir.
Hi.
Yeah, how are you?
Good.
Yeah, sir, I have two questions. First is like we have a B2C app in which we have an algorithm which provides of personalized learning to students and all. But for that, initially, we are accumulating content from different sources like YouTube or and. So I'm going to take the example of YouTube. So it's like the YouTube video will be playing in our app. So our app will act as a browser. As in LinkedIn, if in LinkedIn. So that is so, and we are not making any money out of it right now. So is it okay to use that video without notifying the owner of that particular?
No, that's not correct. You'll have to definitely take permission of that owner who's put that video. Of course, a lot of these videos get circulated all over the internet, and I mean, nobody really cares at the end of the day, because somebody who's, let's say somebody who's made a video in Siberia and you're copying it in Sri Lanka, nobody's going to sue you in Sri Lanka. So from Siberia. So, I mean, that's the farthest example that I can give you on that. But if it's an important video, if you feel that it has created a lot of content or in terms of following, in terms of usage, then, and that person seems like a genuine person who, I don't know what kind of content you're really talking about. Maybe it's educational.
Yeah, it's educational.
Yeah, so somebody's created an educational video and you're copying it and you're putting it on your website. If you give the name of the source of that video and you acknowledge the source, then that is fine.
Okay.
However, if you say that, here's this video and we are the owners, or probably you don't even acknowledge the source of that video, then that's wrong. So till you're putting that video on your website and you're acknowledging the source, saying that XYZ person put it on YouTube on such and such date, let's say, and it has been created by this XYZ person, then it's fine.
So if we put the video in the app and below it, we,
you acknowledge the source, then it's fine.
Okay, great. And the second question is, like, we have heard a lot of questions about, you know, and your answers about how to copyright or patent our own, you know, algorithm technology. So what is the best way to make sure that you are not violating any? So for example, we're building an algorithm and all, and there are companies who might have, actually one of the mentor told us that, you know, you take care of this, that you make sure you're not violating any copyright or algorithm. So what is the easiest way to
check? In your area, in your field of work, I don't think there'll be such an issue, because there's too many players in the market who are doing the same thing. Usually it happens in any business. It happens when you launch a very unique product.
Okay.
And then after some time, somebody tries to copy you. Okay. Once it goes into the market and the market is opened up to many players doing the same thing, it becomes very difficult to protect that idea eventually. If I may give you the example, there are enough antivirus softwares in the market. However, when the first one came out, it had a monopoly in the market, and then the second one came out, then probably there was that aspect of whether you can really get protection over just the fact that you are creating an antivirus software. But you can't do that, because antivirus is something so generic in nature that anybody and everyone can, who has knowledge of creating such a software, can create it and then market it the way they want to.
Yeah.
So it has to be very unique in its concept to be able to seek so much protection that nobody else can do it. I hope I've answered that question. It's a slightly technical concept when it comes to protection of intellectual property. There are various criteria that the courts have set out and the law has set out. So it's a very detailed subject. But on a more layman sort of view, it's usually that it has to be so unique and novel that it gains protection.
Okay, sir. Thanks a lot. That's it from my side.
Okay, thanks, Manu. Tushar, you had some questions.
Hi, sir. Tushar this side.
Yeah, hi.
Right. So my first question is that when we talk of non-voting and voting shares, what kind of rights are given to a shareholder with the voting shares?
Rights are very simple. You vote at a board meeting. Simple. What else?
No, like my at an initial stage, would it be difficult for me at a later stage if I give voting shares earlier to some investors?
That's very difficult to answer because each investor has its own motive and agenda to invest in a company, and each investor has its own ethics and values. Very frankly.
Right.
So we've also had investors who've seemed very, very nice and very mellow at the beginning of the negotiations and while investing in the first round, and eventually have gained so much stake and in the company, and then they start troubling the initial promoters. So it's very difficult to say that that whether it'll be a good option or a bad option. Of course, it also depends on how you negotiate with your investors, because a lot of investors do feel that it's best to have voting rights initially itself rather than gain them later, because they want to really have some sort of control in the working of the company. Right. So totally depends on your negotiation. I don't think there's a straitjacket answer to that.
Okay. My second question would be, we are into edible cutlery products and we are now setting up production partners across the country. Now, can we protect these production partners from producing our products after our agreements expires? Or like, is it possible to prevent it or protect it that they don't do the same kind of business after our agreements or term or the tenure?
You can have a clause in your agreement which you execute with these people to say that this is an exclusive arrangement during dependency of the agreement as well as for a certain period of time after the agreement. Okay. You can always do that. How much will it get protection, or probably whether you'll get damages for that in case they do it? Totally depends on what kind of case you are able to make out in court. But as of now, yeah, you can definitely try to do that in your existing agreement and have a clause with regard to that.
Okay. Fine. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Hello. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes. Yeah.
So, sir, we are working on like one major part of our product is basically news aggregation. So,
aggregation.
Yeah.
Okay.
So right now we are using, let's say, RSS feed of the different legacy players and things like that. So just want to know like more about the IP laws. Like, how can we use the, let's say, this kind of information? So is it legal to use the information for certain purpose, or is it illegal, or let's say we have to do some IP rights or something like that?
No, I think when you're sort of taking these news pieces or news items from other feeds, let's say, it's best to acknowledge the source of that feed.
Yeah, so we are not, let's say, we have provided a read more link and it's always like redirect to the original. This is there, but can we use it for other purpose, like is without any like
other purpose, meaning I don't know.
So summarization,
internal, let's say all kind of internal operations, summarizations and analytics and things like that.
You're talking too technical. I'm a lawyer, but
okay. So there is a short description and a link and a headline that I get, over that a picture. So can I summarize the headline and the short description?
Okay, so can you customize it to your own website? Customize it
to my own thing and like the text part. And
I'll answer that first. A lot of media houses do that. And right in the end, they write a line saying that only the headline has been customized by this website. The contents of the article have been authored by another website or another media house or another news channel. So that can be done. But if till you write that line, it's fine. Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Thanks.
okay. So there's some questions on chat. So if you have like 5 more minutes, we can just address those.
Oh, okay.
So there's Shirish who's asking, from investor point, basic legalities should we keep in mind while making an agreement with a startup?
There are too many. I can't answer that. There are just too many of them. But primary ones would be definitely how much stake you're giving in terms of your either preferential or equity stake for the money that you're getting. Whether you're giving them rights, what kind of rights do you get giving them, voting rights and all that. Then there's dilution of shares when a fresh investment comes in, with whether there will be dilution of shares or not. Apart from that, eventually buybacks, as I had initially said, buyback options. Then these are some things which you should definitely keep in mind. Of course, each company has its own nuances, has its own way of working, so has its own intricacies with the nature of business that they're running. So negotiations have their own way of turning out with each company, with the investor. So these are some of the common ones. The peculiar ones come up when you negotiate.
Got it. And so Akshay has also asked, what key points startups must focus on in signing the term sheet?
Pretty much the same. I think it's just all of that, really. At the end of the day, let's understand, as a layman, I think as a business person, as an entrepreneur, you want to protect your idea. You want to protect your company because you've started it. So what we definitely, while we are representing the startups, we try to tell startups is that don't lose the essence of the company, or don't lose the company to the hands of the investor just because that person is giving you the money. Because eventually, if somebody is giving you the money, he will try to run it the way he wants to. So that is something, that is the ethical basis and foundation that we always tell startups to be in alignment with.
Okay. So before we wrap, does anybody else have any other questions? So I think we're done for today. So thank you so much for joining us. And it was very, very helpful for everyone to just get targeted answers to their respective questions. And we look forward to associating with you further. And this session was organized with the help of Lloyd. So thank you, Sahil and Chandrika from Lloyd, for coordinating with the session. And thank you, sir, for spending one valuable hour of your time today with us.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Stay safe, everybody, and stay home.